You're listening to the Fresh Hell Podcast. Fresh Hell contains stories of a disturbing and often graphic nature and is intended for a mature audience. Please don't let your kids listen to this, or they might turn out like us. Hi, I'm Annie from the US.
And I'm Johanna from Austria, and you are listening to your favorite international podcast. So, we established that we are indeed your favorite international podcast, but I have to say one thing, that you are our favorite international listeners. No, seriously, we have the most awesome audience, and we know that because of your messages, your reviews, and most of all, because of our Facebook group, which has to be the kindest, coolest group on the internet nowadays.
Yes, yes. Also, Opus just came into my room, so I've got Opus today, everyone. If you hear, like, sniffling, crashing noises, like any kind of slobber hitting the microphone, it's the dog, it's not me.
Did you see these two incidents that made me realize really how awesome you are? First of all, our Hellion Katharina once more organized a Secret Santa holiday card swap. So thank you so much, Katharina. You rock, because I know how much work it was.
Oh, yeah.
And the other thing that I really loved, I think it was my favorite thing this week or the last week, a mommy posted in our group that her kid lost his lovey. Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Named Blue Guy. And they had already tried everything to find a replacement, and Blue Guy meant a lot to her son for various reasons. And so she made a post asking if someone would be able to sew a copy of Blue Guy. And what I can tell you is, in just a couple of minutes, several people had offered to sew one. But also, three or four, I think, of our Hellions had immediately found Blue Guys on eBay. I mean, how great are you? So please tell me that this is not the most heartwarming thing ever. And that's why Annie and I can say with absolute certainty that you all out there are the best group of people.
Yeah, that was amazing, because it was this odd toy that had been discontinued. And the thing I loved is I think everybody used a different phrase to search for it based on how they thought it looked, and found different ones on eBay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just the nicest, funniest group of people from all over the world. We love our Facebook group. And also, thank you so much for your ongoing support. And we have, of course, a very special shout out to our newest Patreon members. And they are Janine Shelton, L. McGee, Shannon Willoughby, Melanie Henderson, Mandy Schumacher, and Tanya Sokol. I think Sokol? Sokol. Thanks, Tanya. Thanks, everybody, very much. We really, really appreciate it.
Thank you. So much, really.
Please don't forget that January is coming soon. We still want to hear all of our Patreon theories for what do you think happened. The first episode we'll be doing soon. Send it to us via a message on Patreon or via email at freshhellpodcast@gmail.com. And also a quick reminder for our murder tier listeners that this Friday is game night and I'm back.
Yes.
So yes. I can't wait.
I think we're ready to get into today's episode, the second yes. and final part about Marguerite de Carrouges. If you haven't listened to the first part yet, please pause this one now, right now. Go back to listen to last week's episode. Otherwise, nothing will make sense and you won't enjoy the episode and everything will be doomed forever.
Forever.
And if you did listen last week, but need a quick refresher, Annie will be giving you a quick recap. And just like last week, we will be mentioning sexual assault. We won't get into the details, though, like last week.
No. All right. I love how Annie giving a quick recap is a thing when I'm, like, the worst at quick anything. All right, here we go. Here's a slow Loris recap. All right. It was in the late 70s, the 1370s. So chainmail, not bell bottoms. And the two squires, Jean de Carrouges and Jacques Legris, and they serve the Count de Perche, Pierre d'Alençon. Jean de Carrouges is a brave fighter. His family has supported the kings of France since the beginning of the 100 Years' War. Legris, even though he too participated in war campaigns, some even at the side of Jean de Carrouges, feels more at home at the court of Count Pierre. His charm made him a lot of friends in high places, and he soon became a favorite of the count. Meanwhile, Jean de Carrouges went through some hardship. His first wife and only child had died. Jacques was the son's godfather. That's how close a friend the two men were. But Jean finds a new wife in the 18-year-old Marguerite de Thibauville. Jean is in his 40s, by the way, and the two marry in 1380. The dowry of Marguerite causes some problems, as dowries often do. Jean had set his heart on a piece of land that Marguerite's father had sold to Pierre d'Alençon 3 years prior. So Jean starts a legal battle with the Count, the man he and his family had sworn loyalty to, and of course, he loses. It was definitely not very smart that he decided to sue the Lord in the first place, because from now on, Jean was sort of persona non grata at the court, right? The thing was, Jean didn't blame himself or Count Pierre for all of this, but rather his former friend Jacques Legris. Jean was convinced that Jacques had whispered venomous words into the Count's ear, because the dowry thing was not the only thing that had happened. So the two friends are enemies now, but before long, they make up again after a few years, just to unfriend each other again in 1385.
Unfriend and block.
Yeah, like block. That's all you can really do, isn't it? That's the most severe thing you can do to a person these days. They were blocked. So if after the final breakup, Jacques Legris allegedly rapes Marguerite de Carrouges, Jean's wife, while he is in Paris. Marguerite decides not to stay quiet, and she tells her husband all about it. The two decide to start a legal battle. They lose the first round because the judge is Count Pierre, who of course would never find his favorite court member guilty. And that's pretty much where we left off last week, yeah?
The last thing we mentioned was that Jean and Marguerite knew that they stood no chance at Count Pierre's court, so they didn't even bother to show up.
Yeah, it's like traffic court.
But their goal was something else completely. Jean wanted to travel to Paris to meet with King Charles VI and have him agree to a trial by combat, meaning Jean would face his opponent Jacques in a duel, but more about all the details on this later. Jean instructed all of his supporters to keep gossiping about the rape so that it would be known in every corner of the kingdom, and this way the king would surely hear about it, and it would be so much harder for Charles to ignore Jean, right? So then Jean traveled to Paris, to the Château de Saint-Vincent, the fortress in the east of Paris, just outside of the city. Well, back then, outside of the city. Nowadays, the keep lies in the 12th arrondissement and can be reached easily via subway. The keep was very new when all this took place. It was built in the 1360s, and the young King Charles VI chose it as his main residence. I think he felt safer out there, a little bit further away from the city, because apparently he really needed all the protection he could get. Conspirators seemed to be around every corner. So Jean rode all the way from Normandy to Saint-Vincent, and he told the guards who he was, and that he and his legal advisor were here to see the king. And now the guards walk in, they inform the royal advisor that a knight was here to see the king, and he probably had already heard of the whole case, and so Jean indeed is granted an audience with the 17-year-old king. But of course, first, the Carrouge has to take off all his weapons, except for his sword. It's okay to carry a sword in the palace when you're meeting with the king, no problem at all. And then he followed the servant up the stairs, and after a while he was announced to the king. Now, all these things had to follow a very strict protocol. So Carrouge walked through the hall, stopped where he was told to, bowed, then knelt down before the king. Then, still kneeling, Jean drew his sword and raised it straight up. That's the sign of a request for a trial by combat. Still kneeling, still raising his sword above his head, careful not to point it at his king.
Yeah, that's a big no-no.
And so Jean tells the French ruler that he was there today to request an appeal. The king basically answered, okay, I'm listening, tell me all about it. Which meant Jean was allowed to lower his sword, and then he told the king the whole story, ending with a request to face the man he accused in a duel. The king granted the appeal. I'm sure after hearing all the rumors for weeks now, he was very intrigued by the whole thing. I mean, what else was there to do except for planning some new war campaigns against England?
Oh yeah, no, this information, this whole thing would be fascinating to everybody, right? What else were you going to do? So the first step was to summon the accused, Jacques Legris, to Paris. So a letter was sent. While Jacques probably knew that this had been the knight's plan, he still must have been at least a little bit surprised. His buddy Pierre had sent a letter to his cousin the king, basically asking him to make the whole thing go away, and Charles VI had decided against it. So now Jacques Legris has to travel to Paris. He and Jean have to stay in the city, but they can move around the city somewhat freely in theory. But, you know, in reality, they have to be prepared to be summoned to the court at any time. Of course, not only Jean has to stay in Paris, his wife Marguerite has to be there too. And there's one thing we haven't told you yet. Jean and Marguerite are married now for over 5 years, and so far they did not have a child. Marguerite had never been pregnant, but now she is, and as far as anyone can guess, time-wise, the father could be either Jean or Jacques.
Yeah, but if Marguerite was indeed raped by Jacques, he could not be the father. And I hear a lot of head scratching right now. The thing is, medieval scientists were absolute certain that in order to get pregnant, a female orgasm was needed. Only when the woman orgasmed, her ovaries would release an egg and she could be impregnated. As rape was not enjoyable, at least the mostly male experts agreed on that part, rape could not get a woman pregnant. And while the female orgasm indeed can help to transport the sperm faster to where it needs to go, we know now it absolutely is not necessary to get pregnant. If the female orgasm was necessary, we would have a lot less humans walking around on this planet.
A lot less. A lot less. And the sad thing is, there are still politicians who will claim that in America, that you claim you can't get pregnant from rape or incest. It's a lie, just to be absolutely, and this is not political, this is facts, you are equally likely to get pregnant regardless as to how much you enjoy or even consent to sex, just so that's crystal clear.
I don't think that's only in the United States of America. That's pretty much all over the world.
It's why it's all men, generally, that say this, but it's just insane to me that in this day and age, and now we know it goes back to medieval times, so that's no surprise. It's more understandable back then. Today, it's just no. Sex results in pregnancy. End of story. And we have a pregnant lady here. Not end of story, because there's a lot more going on with this particular pregnancy. So there was still the possibility that Marguerite was actually pregnant by another third man. But Jean was absolutely firm on him being the father. He said they did have sex after he had returned to Scotland, and she must have especially enjoyed it after being separated from her husband for many months. Okay, so now not only Jean had a legal advisor, but also Jacques consulted with one. And this man had the wonderful name of Jean Lecoq, lawyer to the stars. Yeah, it was all going fine till we brought the cock into it. But I think we just have to refer to him as Lecoq because there's two Jeans now and we don't want to confuse them. And he was the legal advisor to many high-ranking noble officials. And so Lecoq advised Jacques, oh my, to make use of his former affiliation to the church. We told you last week that he was able to read and write. That's because as a young boy, he was actually on his way to becoming a priest. But once he was in his teenage years, he was like, you know what? I like the ladies. This isn't the right move for me. I know several people for whom that was the case, so no judgment. But if Jacques had decided to join the clergy again, he could only be tried by the church, not by any worldly court. And we can all imagine how that would go. If Jacques were to take this route, he would definitely never have to face his opponent in a duel. And the lawyer really urged Legris to follow his advice.
Yeah, but Jacques refused. I think he was a very, very proud man, and following his lawyer's advice would have felt like running, and people at court would definitely view it as some kind of admission of guilt, I guess. So, you know, if he would do that, they would forever talk behind his back. Maybe not forever, but definitely until the next best scandal would come around.
Who knows how long that could be.
Yeah. And maybe he was pretty certain the court would never agree to a trial by compote, because by the late 14th century, they had become very rare. And it had been actually 30 years since it was last granted in a rape case. Also, is it weird for anybody else when you hear of medieval lawyers?
Yes.
I mean, of course, the Middle Ages were not completely lawless, quite on the contrary, but I don't know, in my head, I can picture Saul Goodman with fleshy suit and his briefcase representing, you know, a medieval squire.
That's right.
Ah, sorry, moving on. Okay, next was kind of a court hearing where both parties had to appear at the Palace of Justice in Paris and they had to make their case. And of course, Jacques Legree denied all accusation and pleaded guilty. Jean had to throw his gauntlet to the floor after naming all the things Jacques was accused of. It was several things, rape of course, then also incest. Because remember, he was the godfather of Jean's first child. And according to medieval law, this kind of made him related to Marguerite.
Yeah.
Then Jacques Legree had to pick up the gauntlet, you know, that meant he was accepting the challenge. Now we already know what Jean and Marguerite said happened, but here are the arguments Jacques used to prove his innocence. He had spent the night before in his room at Argentan. The travel from Argentan to Cap-au-Mesnil, where the crime allegedly had taken place, would have taken somewhere around 6 hours, 9 hours, depending on your horses. You would have to switch the horses every few miles because you were galloping. Jacques was in his late 40s, early 50s. He argued that he was not fit enough anymore to make such a travel at such a speed on horseback. Then he said, Jean's mother was attending to business in a nearby town, so she was probably only gone for 9 to 12 hours. So in this time, Jacques would have needed to make his way from Argentan, gain access to the castle, rape Marguerite, leave again, and starting to make his way back. And in his opinion, this was absolutely impossible. If Marguerite had put up such a fight that two men were struggling to tie her to the bed, how come that Legree had never shown any signs of wounds, no scratches, no bite marks? Jacques Legree was sure that any bruises Marguerite showed were actually from her husband, who would beat her regularly. According to Legree, Jean had tried the same thing already years ago. He was trying to get his first wife, Jeanne de Tilly, to accuse Legree of raping her. Adam Louvel and the maid who was left at Cap-au-Mesnil had been brought in for questioning. What was meant by that was that they were actually tortured. Even the poor maid who had nothing to do with any of it and who swore that she hadn't seen or heard anything. And even though they were tortured, the maid as well as Adam Louvel didn't even cave. They completely stayed firm in what they had stated previously. Then he said the castle was surrounded by houses. Clearly someone would have heard Marguerite screaming. And his last argument, and this is a real explosive one, he stated that not even Jean's mother, Madame Nicole, believed that the rape had occurred. Nicole de Carrouges had testified that when she had returned after being gone for not even half the day, Marguerite was her friendly, happy self. She hadn't appeared quiet, depressed, or in any way different. Nicole was absolutely convinced that no crime had occurred.
And now it was Jean's turn again. According to Jean, Jacques was very wealthy. Clearly he could afford to have horses stationed along the way, and he was definitely fit enough to make the ride. Jean had never once in his life hit his wife. He said they lived a very happy and respectful marriage, at least according to him. Who knows if he had really spent the previous night in his room at Argentan? Nobody could testify to that. Maybe he was already in Cap-au-Mesnil, at Adam Louvel's house, waiting for Marguerite to be left alone. And as a witness to his whereabouts before the crime, he had named two men. One of them was at that moment facing rape charges of his own, so that's the kind of friends he had. This went on for a while. Of course, also friends and family were heard out. Marguerite had to give a statement, which must have been such an ordeal, as she was now 6 months pregnant, and she once more had to stand there in front of everybody giving a detailed description of the happenings of that day. A summary of these statements and the whole case, written in Latin, still exists, and Eric Jaeger describes it as, quote, nearly 10 densely written folio-sized pages in faded brown ink, end quote.
Well, at least they didn't ramble on for 18 pages front and back.
And back. That's the killer. In the end, Jacques made sure once more to declare his innocence. And, for slandering his good name, he asked for 40,000 gold francs as compensation from Jean de Carrouges. This was a huge amount, serious horse and heirloom carpet money. This would actually mean bankruptcy for the Carrouges family. The fascinating thing is that there are still some documents and notes in existence that give a lot of details about this case. As we told you, the author Eric Jaeger traveled to the archives, he studied them. One of them is particularly interesting. It's the notes of Jean Lecoq, Jacques' attorney. There are still some pages left to this day, and they are kept at the French National Library. And what makes them so special is not only did the lawyer take notes about the legal steps, but he also wrote down his own personal thoughts. For example, he wrote about one incident when Legree had asked Lecoq if he thought that he was guilty, and the lawyer didn't answer immediately, which made Jacques believe that his own legal advisor didn't believe in his innocence. And indeed, he did not. He noted that he could believe both versions, so either Jacques being a rapist or Jean and Marguerite being liars, and that probably no one will ever know the truth about what really happened.
Another thing that he found very suspicious, apparently, that was after Jacques Legree found out that Jean was accusing him of raping his wife, he immediately went to the church, to his priest, to confess something. We don't know what. But Jean Lecoq was like, well, why was that the first thing he did, right?
Yeah, the very first thing. That's kind of suspicious. If someone accuses you of a crime and your first thing is to run to a priest, it doesn't look good. That's all I'm saying. Doesn't look good. And the group of judges at the Palace of Justice felt the same way. They were unable to come to a decision. What added to their hesitancy in deciding who was right and who was wrong was the fact that this had turned into a really high-profile case, and almost all the noble families in France had picked a side they supported. No matter what the verdict would be, you were always going to step on very influential toes. Mm. And so, fuck that. Let them fight it out amongst themselves, right? Not my problem.
Exactly. A trial by combat was granted, and this meant that God would decide who was right and who was the criminal. It meant that the two men would face each other in a life or death duel. One man would leave this duel alive, and he was automatically the one who was right. So if Jean killed Jacques in the duel, that meant that Jacques was definitely a rapist. If Jean was killed by Jacques, on the other hand, this would prove that Jean had lied. But not only Jean, also Marguerite, and she would also be charged for making false rape accusations and for giving false testimony. She would be burned at the stake as punishment immediately after the duel, by the way. So they would just, you know, take her, put her on the stake, burn her.
Her heavily pregnant body, and just...
They would never burn a pregnant woman.
Would they wait? I wasn't sure if they would wait or not.
Yeah. They timed the duel for after she gave birth.
Right. You gotta get the baby out, and then...
Yeah, because it's a new Christian soul.
Baptize it. Yeah, that's right.
So yeah, there was much at stake here. No pun intended. Which is also the number one reason why I do think that there was something to the rape allegations. I can see Jean making everything up. I can really see that, because he had started to hate Jacques so much. Yeah, I can see him even forcing Marguerite, you know, to play along. But risk being burned alive? I doubt it. But then, what if she didn't knew that beforehand? Before they started all of this? I don't know.
Maybe.
What do you think? It's
difficult. I can't see any reason she would lie about it. Like, this doesn't seem like the kind of trouble you'd intentionally bring onto your own house either way, right? It just doesn't make sense, I don't think. Yeah. As you said, there's just far too much at risk.
I think we could really find arguments and explanations for one side or the other and still wouldn't really know for sure, right?
Yeah.
It's definitely all very circumstantial. So, yeah, let's let God decide.
Yeah.
Now, preparations needed to be made. You don't just organize such an event in a day. And as I already mentioned, they also had to wait until the baby was born. The preparations actually took months. So first of all, they needed to wait with the duel until the king would return to Paris, because at the moment he was off on another war campaign. This time he had sent ships over the channel. Well, no, that was the plan. King Charles and his advisors had traveled to Flanders to oversee the send-off of his armada to fight the English, who else, in their homeland. Because, they tried that several times. But guess what? The invasion was cancelled last minute due to very, very bad signs. So first, thunderstorms, weather so bad that some of the ships sank, many men lost their lives, trees were uprooted, then a church was struck by lightning. And last but not least, the most ominous sign, a murder of cross carrying burning pieces of coal through the air and throwing it at the roofs of farmhouses.
That last bit is my favorite. It's so medieval over the top. Like, ooh, all these people died in a storm. Like, oh yeah, that's bad. Oh, but then lightning struck the church. Like, yeah, churches have steeples and get hit by lightning. Like, it's a thing. It happens. It is known. But then the crows showed up and started lighting shit on fire. Okay, well, now you have my attention.
How would that even work? How can a crow carry a burning piece of coal?
Very carefully. So carefully. I mean, I'm not If it was any other bird species, I'd be like, well, that's bullshit. But it was crows, so like, yeah, maybe? Maybe. But sorry, please go on. I just love that detail. It like, it just keeps getting more and more dramatic until we've got arsonist crows, which is, you know, impressive.
So many buildings, especially grain storages, were burned to the ground. That's not good. So the French noped right out of that planned invasion, and the king and his posse returned to Paris. And then a place had to be found big enough for all the people who wanted to attend the spectacle. The duel was set to take place at the grounds of the monastery at Saint-Martin-de-Champs, because it was one of the two monasteries that had its own battlefield in Paris. You know, it might sound weird, a monastery with a battlefield, excuse me, what's going on? But Saint-Martin-de-Champs was actually the place where tribunals were held for the surrounding area. There was also a prison, there was a lot going on. They even, you know, trialed animals.
Yeah, there was... That monastery had a lot of pans on the fire.
The first buildings of this monastery were constructed in the 8th century, and it was called Saint-Martin-de-Champs because it was surrounded by lush and fertile fields, champ meaning field in French. Of course, nowadays it's not outside of Paris. There are no more fields surrounding it, but there are still some of the medieval structures left. For example, the former refectory. It's actually really beautiful. If you ever have the chance to visit, please go. Nowadays, you also find the Museum of Arts and Crafts there, where you can look at all the macaroni pictures that people made, with glitter, without glitter.
The herpes of the craft world.
The most fascinating part for me was that the original Foucault pendulum was housed there from 1855 up until 2010, when it was unfortunately damaged beyond repair. Of course, we know there exist more Foucault pendulums around the world now, and one even in Paris, in the dome of the Pantheon. It is an exact replica of the original.
Oh, cool. There's one at the Museum of Science in Boston, too. It's one of those things when you see one that it's such a simple thing, but I find myself all of a sudden 15 minutes have passed and you've just been staring at this pendulum and it's like, oh, okay, it's very zen. All right, sorry.
So back to 1386. Even back then, there were no more fields surrounding the priory, but still, there was enough space to set up the battlefield on the tournament ground and scaffolding for all the spectators and so on. And I say that they had to set up the battlefield, because even though the monastery had its own battlefield, it had to be adapted to fulfill the required standards. Over the decades, as trial by combat had become rarer and rarer, the monastery battleground had been turned into a place for jousting and other more or less dangerous forms of tournament. Now, those tournament fields were actually longer than the ones allowed for trial by combat. Also, a wall had to be built, a wall way taller than a man surrounding the whole field. This was done so that neither man could try to flee from the battleground. Of course, it was also
Run
to
away.
Protect the spectators, but I mean, let's be realistic. It was totally there to prevent the men from running off.
Absolutely.
Also, the ground of the battlefield was super important. It was thoroughly raked, any objects were removed, everything was evened out to give the men fair fighting conditions, and then the soil was covered with fine sand, you know, to soak up the blood.
Yeah.
At each corner of the field there was a tower, and officials would be up there watching every move of the fighters. Also, from the towers, two men could be supplied with food and drinks if needed. Only one of them would leave the field alive, at most. Of course, it was always possible that both would die. In that case, the winner would be the one who managed to stay alive longer. And if they didn't manage to end this once and for all until sunset, the two would get some night's rest and come back the next day, you know, all refreshed and happy and healthy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And the next day, the next day, and the next day, and the next day, until one of them was no more. Of course, I don't think there was ever a combat that lasted over 2 days. If I'm wrong, and one of you knows of one, please send us a message.
We'll cover it. Yeah. So while all this was going on, Marguerite had given birth to her son, Robert. The interesting thing is, around the same time as Jean and Marguerite's son was born, King Charles VI's wife, Isabeau of Bavaria, had given birth to a son as well. But while the Carrouges boy was strong and healthy, sadly, the royal heir was sick and died soon after his birth on the 28th of December, 1386, one day before the duel was set to take place.
The story of Isabeau and Charles is actually quite sweet. Of course, the young king was not allowed to pick his own bride. Isabeau was chosen for him. She had to undergo very strict inspection, as it was customary at the French court. She had to strip down naked, and the ladies at court looked at the 16-year-old body, making sure that she was healthy and looked fit enough to bear many children. That was not the sweet part, of course. That's pretty degrading and horrible. But what was sweet, in a way, a little bit sweet. When Charles was introduced to his future wife, he actually genuinely fell in love with her. But then on the other hand, he also fell in love with a picture he once saw of a possible bride. So, yeah.
I mean...
it's medieval times, you know.
Listen, it could have been worse. Well, it did get worse.
It was so much worse because the rest of Charles' life is not so sweet and lovely. In his mid-20s, he started to show signs of psychosis. Mental illnesses ran in his mother's side of the family. He later suffered from glass delusion, a mental disorder that made people believe they are made from glass and could shatter at any moment. More common in the medieval times. It's not such a thing nowadays, apparently.
It's terrifying, though. Like, the idea of that is truly terrifying.
Let's be honest, though. I mean, if you grew up in a period known as the 100 Years' War, and you are orphaned at age 11, and you immediately become king, I mean, who wouldn't develop a mental health issue, right?
Oh, he was starting with deficits to begin with. So, and again, we've said so many times, with mental health problems, there was, let me give you some leeches about it, try some cocaine. Like, they're just, have some opium to calm you down. There was nothing.
There would be so many more things we could talk about here when it comes to King Charles VI and his family. But again, this would be a whole other standalone episode, but it's fascinating. It's really fascinating.
It is. I can't take another review of, if I could care less about Charles VI and how crazy he was, I would be dead. All right.
Yeah, but then somebody else comes and says, well, you always tell us we don't need to know more about
it. Well, that's true. You can't please anybody, ever. No, it really is fascinating, and it's tragic, and I'm sure that Marguerite grew more and more worried about the outcome of this whole thing, especially now that she had an infant child to take care of. She must have questioned her decision to speak up several times, but there was no turning back now. So on the 29th of December, 1386, thousands of spectators poured into the monastery grounds. The high-ranking nobility were seated in their private boxes, where they had the best view of the carnage. Potential carnage. The king was there, as were many of his family. Of course, Count Pierre de Perche was there as well. Then the places on scaffolding for the commoners, depending on your rank in society, were filled up. And as for the biggest part of the crowd, it was the simple peasants. They gathered around the battlefield, and if they were lucky, they were in the first row and found a crack in the wooden wall to peek through. Also, in a box on the scaffolding, surrounded by guards, was Marguerite de Carrouges, dressed in black. Just getting ready for mourning, I guess.
And for getting burned.
And for getting burned at the stake, that's right. You gotta look good for that. Then the two men who had risen early, had bathed and gone to church, entered the battleground through two gates on the opposite sides of the field. Jean de Carrouges, as the accuser, was on the right side of the grounds. Jacques Legris, as the accused, on the left side. They were in full armor, which meant a light linen tunic as an undergarment, then heavier linen with padding, especially for the nether regions. The feet were in cloth or leather shoes, and then over that, the metal sabaton, which was the armor to protect your feet. Then chainmail leggings, and then over that, the metal plate armor to protect the shins, knees, and front of the thighs. Then a chainmail skirt and a chainmail shirt, and over that goes the metal breastplate. Then plates on the shoulders, like shoulder pads, plates on the upper arms, plates on the elbows, plates on the forearms, then chainmail gloves and metal gauntlets, a metal collar to protect the delicate neck region, and then on their heads, a leather cap. Over it, more chainmail. That again covered the back of the neck. So think like a chainmail mullet. Yeah? It's good. And then the metal helmet with a visor.
I think that's a lot of metal for December.
That's right. And now you're ready to get on your motorcycle and proceed safely and cautiously. No. All right, I forgot. You could also only see and breathe through teeny tiny little slits in the armor. So here is your 60 pounds of armor. Good fucking luck to you battling for your life. And not only the two men were in full armor, so were their stallions, huge horses, especially bred for battle, weighing around 1,400 pounds or 700 kilogram. Other adult horses would weigh like 900 to 1,000 pounds, 400 to 500 kilograms. So these were big horses. All of their weapons were checked very thoroughly, making sure everything was in working order. You wanted to make sure all your pointy ends were real sharp, right? You don't want dull pointy bits. And what Eric Jaeger came up with in terms of weapons that De Carrouges and Legris probably used in the duel, he had, like, as we said, he had studied the manuscript, but he also looked at illustrations and had read up on other judicial combats that had taken place around the same time. And so this is how we know what would happen next. So they would start out on the horse carrying an extremely sharp lancet. This is not like jousting. This is a very, very sharp instrument that they are holding, and they charge full force at one another. And once they're off the horses, for reasons that we're not going to get into, they would use two swords, a long, heavy, two-handed sword for heavy blows aiming to destroy armor, and a smaller sword that was light enough to use with one hand. Then they also had an axe, because do we ever tell a story if there's no axe?
True. All the axes, all the time.
All the time. And then lastly, of course, a dagger for the ultimate in close combat. The dagger was really handy to penetrate those tiny slits and cracks in the metal armor. And of course, you had a shield painted in the family's coats of armor. The used weapons, of course, had to be of equal length and weight, otherwise it would give an unfair advantage. And of course, the weapons had to be checked for spells, magic, or any other sort of sorcery.
It's important. It's important, yeah. No
facts.
Cursed or magically enhanced weapons.
Mm-mm. Keep the crows away from it. Yeah. And also, Legris was knighted right before the start of the duel because both opponents had to be of the same social rank, which was a technicality. But truth be told, there was a slight advantage for Jacques. He was taller, he was wealthier and could afford better equipment, and he was healthy. Jean de Carrouges, on the other hand, was still recovering from the illness he had brought home from the Scottish campaign. The only thing that spoke for Jean was that he was the more experienced fighter. Can you all picture it? These two men, all in their layers of metal, on their huge horses, who are also covered in metal and with all the weaponry on them? It's just... it's so much metal.
Imagine we could really travel back in time and just... I think it's quite... an impressive thing to see.
Oh, yeah.
Impressive. Scary. Scary impressive.
Quite a sight to behold.
The night before, both opponents had prayers said for them in all churches of Paris, begging God to lead one or the other to victory. The day of the duel was probably cold, as weather records should suggest that this was a rather harsh winter. But that didn't stop the cheerful crowd to flock to Saint-Martin de Champs from the early morning hours on. Everybody, of course, trying to get a place where they could see what was going on. Then, finally, the fanfares announced the arrival of the king and his entourage. The crowd oohed and aahed, and most of them probably never saw their king before. I also don't think that the crowd in the cheap ranks were there to support one of those men. They probably didn't even know too much of who was who and why and all those details. But you know, there was no Netflix, no internet, no bathtub and a good book. So you took what you could get when it came to entertainment.
Oh yeah.
And when the king finally sat down, the two men down on the battleground positioned themselves below the throne and addressed their ruler, stating again who they were, why they were battling on this day. Then they both presented a parchment with the written statement and all the charges. Then a herald entered the battlefield, loudly announcing all the rules and regulations of the duel that was about to take place. The rules for the crowd, by the way. So one of the rules was that everybody in the crowd had to stay seated, reminds me of a Beach Boys concert, and that nobody was allowed to obstruct the view of any other spectator. If you didn't follow this rule, you could get one hand chopped off. Also, nobody in the crowd was allowed to gesture, spit, or cough, or yell. This offense was punishable by death. I mean, that sounds like fun, right? By the way, as for the two knights, there were basically no rules. They could do whatever they needed to do during the fight, even throw sand at the opponent's eyes, for example. In one of those trial by combats, one man was killed because the other man ripped his scrotum out, his testicles, with his bare hand.
That's... sorry about that. Gonna leave a mark.
Now the king declared the battlefield as opened, and from that moment on, everything was in God's hand, and very clearly the right person would win this battle. An official yelled, "Do your duty," and the two men mounted their horses. They were ready, the lance on one side, and when the official yelled, "Let them go," the two riders started charging at each other.
Yeesh. So it took a little over 5 seconds to get close enough for one of them to hit the opponent with the lance. And you have to take the speed and weight into account. Apparently, they would crash into each other with over a ton of weight. And they actually really did manage to hit the other one's shield at the same time. So it was a surprise that the lances didn't penetrate the shield and armor. But both riders were thrown backwards in their saddles, but still holding on for dear life. They quickly regained balance and managed to turn the horses around, galloping back to the end of the field and starting the attack all over again. This time, they aimed the lances for the helmets, but the blades only scratched over the surface with such a force that, according to chronicles, sparks could be seen flying off, and then back again. After a few moments' break to catch their breath, they charged each other for the third time. This time, they hit the shields of one another with such a force that the lances simply shattered into pieces. Again, they were almost thrown from their horses, but again, they managed to stay in the saddle. Now without lances, they grabbed their axes and now approached each other a little bit slower. I mean, you have to with an axe. So they're circling their horses around each other in close proximity, just waiting until one of them could land a first blow. They tried to throw each other off the horses, striking at each other with the axes, having their horses come so close to one another that the combatants almost touched by their chests. This went on for several minutes, and the men clearly grew tired. Then suddenly, Legris broke apart, galloping his horse away from Jean, only to quickly turn it around, charging at his accuser full on. This way, he managed to get the rider off his horse, and now with Jean on the ground, Legris has the upper hand. Again, he spurs his horse on, ready to administer another blow with the axe, but just at the last moment, Jean de Carrouges jumps out of the way, causing Jacques to lose his balance, and now they're both on the ground. And the men pause to breathe for a moment. Carrouges now draws his sword and starts the next attack. And now Jean and Jacques are hacking at each other with their swords, when for whatever reason, Legris finally finds an opening in Carrouges' defense, and he manages to stab him in the thigh. Blood starts pouring down Jean's leg, and we all know that he could very well bleed out from such a wound. This was not good. The crowd is silent, Marguerite is watching in horror, and everyone thought this is the moment that Jean de Carrouges was mortally wounded and that the whole thing would be over in just a few moments. But Jacques pulled the sword from the wound and started to move backwards away from Jean, probably waiting for his challenger to fall on the ground. But no. Jean used the moment when Jacques withdrew to launch at him. He grabbed the taller man and flung him to the ground. Nobody expected that the wounded knight still had so much strength left in him. Carrouges is now towering over Legris, aiming his sword at his opponent and demanding that Legris finally admit his crime. Jacques Legris refuses, still swearing his innocence. Jean de Carrouges saw that Legris was trying to reach for his sword, which he had dropped when Carrouges had pushed him down, and with a movement of his foot, kicks the sword out of reach. Then he falls onto his knee, basically sitting on Legris' chest. Jean de Carrouges opened his opponent's helmet, which was very difficult with those metal gloves on, and he held his dagger to Jacques' chin. One more time, the knight yells, "Confess." But again, the other swore to God that he was innocent. And that was the last thing he would ever say, because Jean had just about had it, and with one swift movement, he shoved the dagger through Legris' chin, upwards.
Yeah, and that was it. That was the end of Jacques Legris. Carrouges, regaining some strength, made his way over to the king, bowed before him, and asked, "Did I do my duty?" He was the winner. God had spoken, and now it was very clear to everybody that Jacques Legris had raped Marguerite de Carrouges. So yeah, now finally the crowd was allowed to cheer, and the sound of thousands of people yelling his name and clapping must have felt overwhelming to Marguerite and Jean. A doctor started to attend to Jean's wound, thank God, before the guards did release Marguerite and he could be reunited with his wife. By the way, the knight was not only the winner and saved his and his wife's life, he was also rewarded by the king with a nice yearly pension, and he was also made a member of his chamber, which was very generous. After the duel, as it was custom, Jean mounted one of his horses, still in his dirty and bloody armor, and in a procession, he and his supporters made their way to Notre Dame, where they said a prayer and thanked the Lord for his fair judgment. And what happened to Jacques' remains? Well, his body was tied to a horse and drawn from Saumur to the gallows at Montfaucon, where Legris was displayed for several days so everybody could take a good long look at the criminal.
I bet those pyromaniac crows were pretty psyched about that development. Nom nom nom.
Now, Jean and Marguerite were really well known all over France, and they had a nice life with the yearly pension, Jean's new position, and the money they were awarded from Jacques' estate as a form of compensation. Jean was later even promoted to a Knight of the King, and now he was in the inner circle of the King's court in Paris. And guess what? Of course, Jean, stubborn as he was, tried to once more purchase the piece of land that had pretty much started all of this, Anneau-le-Faucon, but once more failed. It was Count Pierre's land, after all.
It was not to be. Let it
was
go,
not,
man.
It was not meant to be.
No.
Marguerite and Jean had two more sons, and they lived happily ever after. Or not. Because in 1396, Jean joined one of the Crusades and never returned. He probably fell in the Battle of Nicopolis. To this day, there are many speculations surrounding this case. Was Jacques really guilty? Had Jean made up a lie to get rid of his enemy? You know, the man he had made responsible for his own misfortune. Was Marguerite really raped, but had simply mistaken her attacker for Jacques, who she had only seen once before? Did she accuse Jacques to cover up an affair with another man, the father of Robert? Some think that years after the duel, a man came forward admitting the rape, and that that was the reason for Jean to join a crusade, and that Marguerite was so guilt-stricken that she became a nun after her husband's death. But I think, honestly, that's just gossip and speculation. I honestly don't think that Jean really needed such a weird reason to join a crusade. I think he would have joined freely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
There is also no proof that Marguerite joined a nunnery. It looks as if she stayed at Castle de Carrouges and took care of business until her son Robert was old enough to take over.
It's such an interesting story. I think that crusaders are going to crusade, right? I mean, it's kind of what they do.
Definitely.
Yeah, and it's also no surprise that he didn't come back. It's always interesting to me. It's like, well, he went off to the Crusades and didn't come back. And it's like, is that a surprise?
I think it's more of a surprise if you return.
Yeah. Yeah, right. It's such an interesting story, though. And yeah, I'm looking forward to watching the film. I haven't watched it yet.
I really liked it. I think Ridley Scott is nowadays often a little bit hit and miss, you know what I mean? But this one, it was really, really good. It was very true to the source material. The only thing I didn't like was some of his casting choices, I have to be honest.
Okay.
Ben Affleck as Count Pierre de Perche. I don't know, I don't see it. Adam Driver. It's so hard for me to hate him in the movie because he's just gorgeous and I love him. And I really liked how it was set up. They make three parts. It's the truth according to Jean de Carrouges, the truth according to Jacques Legris, and then it starts with the truth according to Marguerite, and then it just says the truth, which is Marguerite's story. And I like this kind of plot device that is called the unreliable narrator. I don't know if you know the, like, Rashomon or the TV show The Affair plays with these kind of things, yeah. I can really recommend the movie, and it's on Disney Plus to stream, so.
Nice.
You have something good?
Yeah, we had a little bit of a scary moment over the weekend. We had to rush Opus to emergency care, and we're still not exactly sure what was going on with him. He was fine, and then he was just very shaky and, like, seemed to be having trouble walking. It was a really long day, and he's now on some steroids and some pain meds, and they think it might just be some neck pain. He's so much better now that I'm wondering if it was maybe growing pains, like if he was having, because his shoulders did feel pretty warm. But we're just keeping an eye on him, but you might have heard him chomping on his faux hide or prancing around behind me while we were recording as I'm keeping eyeballs on him. He's feeling much, much better. So that's my something good.
I'm so glad. The video you sent me was really scary.
Right?
I really thought he had, like I told you, maybe antifreeze, or he ate something, or he found something somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or a bloat, as you said.
Mm. Yeah.
My something good is very superficial. I've been to the hairdresser today, and I feel amazing.
It looks beautiful.
The last time, it was 6 months ago. Then there was another lockdown here, and I had an appointment, and then lockdown happened, like, all the time. And I could finally go today, and it's so good. And it's shorter. It's like a chin-length bob now. But it feels
good. It looks great.
So that's my something good. I feel nice with my new haircut.
It looks amazing. I love it.
People out there, if you liked this episode or any of our episodes or all of our episodes, please do us a huge favor. Go to your podcast app and check if you could leave us a rating and or review. It would help us out so much, and it really makes our day if you write something nice.
It does. Tremendously so. That's what we would really like for Christmas. Please, it's just a review. That would be super. Thank you. If you need information on how to get a hold of us, you can please visit our website, which is freshhellpodcast.com. That's where you will find links to where to listen to us, how to get in touch with us. All that kind of information is there. P.O. Box. You'll also find a link to our merch. There is still 15% off with the code BLACKHELL, our Black Friday sale. We've just extended it through the 31st of December in case you want to treat yourself or a loved one to some nice, cozy, Fresh Hell merch. Again, Black Hell.
The hoodies are really good.
The hoodies are super comfy. Actually, the t-shirts are really good too. I need to order a few more. I'm kind of living in mine. You'll also find information on our Patreon there. You can also go to patreon.com and type in Fresh Hell Podcast to find our feed there. We have some exciting stuff coming up we're looking forward to very much. And I think that's everything, yeah?
Yeah. Tell your pets we said hi and we love them. This week, especially the horses out there. If you have a horse, cuddle them, give them, I don't know, apples, carrots as a treat from us. And I think that's all I have to say about pets today. You know the deal. We love all of them, even the creepy ones that we actually don't like.
That's
but they're your pets and they make you happy, and that's why we like them. So there you go.
That's right.
Give your fellow human being the benefit of the doubt. I don't know. That's it. That's it. I'm tired. My words are not in my brain today.
Yeah, the words are... Some days the words are hard. So, if you, like so many of us right now, are going through hell...
Keep riding on your huge battle horse through hell.
Yes.
Tschüss.
Bye.